Hi friends, in the previous video we understood the basic of JavaScript. In this video we are going to make our first Snowflake stored procedure. Snowflake exposes a JavaScript API to develop stored procedure. The starting point of this API is a global object called Snowflake, which is by default present in our JavaScript code. With the help of this object we can execute a sequence of steps to run our query and extract result set. So let's begin with JavaScript API and go through the sequence of steps. So friends, I have listed down all the steps to create the stored procedure. So the step one is prepare the query variable by assigning a SQL query. So we are going to create a query variable and which will hold our SQL query which we want to execute on Snowflake. Step two is we are going to create a statement object. We can create this statement object with the help of Snowflake object which is already present in JavaScript API. And we are going to call its createStatement function by passing a JSON object. This JSON object is going to contain two key value pairs. First key is SQL text and its value will be our query object which we created in the step 1. The second key will be the binds and its value will be an JSON array which will hold our input parameter which we want to bind with our query. In step 3, we are going to get result set and we can get the result set with the help of statement object which we get in the step 2 by calling its execute function. So there are some important points to consider. The first point is we should pass all input parameter name in capital case and this is optional. So in our create stored procedure command we are going to pass input parameters and we should pass them in capital case, but this is optional. We should use these input parameters in JavaScript in capital case and this is mandatory. So whenever we are going to refer this input parameter in our JavaScript, we are going to pass them in capital case and this is mandatory, because if we don't do this our stored process is going to throw error on runtime. So what is the reason behind it? By default SQL converts all the input parameter in capital case, but same is not true for the JavaScript variable. So and JavaScript are case sensitive in nature, so that's why we should do this. Let's move toward the next point. We should bind input parameter with the query, or alternatively we can concat input parameter with query. So over here you can see we are binding our input parameters with our query, and suppose if you don't pass this bind, then what you can do is you can concat this input parameter into your query variable itself. Next point is to access each row from result set we need to call resultset.next function one time. So for every row we have to call this function, and after calling this function our row will be present into our result set object and we can iterate over it. So that's it friend, this is all about JavaScript API. Now let's see the structure of create or replace stored procedure command. So this is the structure: create or replace procedure. After that we have to give the procedure name, and after that we are going to give our input parameter and its data type. After that there is a returns keyword, and after that we are going to give the data type of our return value. After that we are using language keyword and we have to give languages JavaScript. After this comes S, and after that there are double dollar symbol. In between this double dollar symbol we are going to write our JavaScript code. So let's start. Let's write our first JavaScript stored procedure. Let me open my Snowflake console. So we are going to create a stored procedure. So let me tell you what we are going to do in that stored procedure. We have one employee table. Let me preview it. We have several columns over here. We are going to look for employee name and department number. So our stored procedure is going to take department number and going to fetch employee name for that department. So let's create the stored procedure. Let me copy the structure. Let me give the name. So there will be one attribute, that is department number. Over here we are giving data type as float. So one question might arise that department number is an integer column, then why we are giving float data type? So as we know, in stored procedure our input parameter are get converted into JavaScript variables. So there is an inherent conversion going on, and Snowflake does not provide us any integer data type which get converted into JavaScript data type. So let me show you a table. Over here we can see there is a SQL data type and JavaScript data type. In the number section we can see there is a float and double, and that can get converted into number data type of JavaScript. So but there is no integer, so that's why we are taking department number as float. Let me give the return type. So I'm going to return an array. Now let me write my JavaScript code. So as mentioned previously, let's make our query variable. Let me give it a query. So my query will be and over here we are going to give question mark, because at the place of this question mark we are going to pass department number, and we are going to do it while creating the statement object. Now let's create the statement object. We are going to use snowflake object. This is a global object which is by default provided by Snowflake JavaScript API. Let's call its create statement function. And here I'm going to give one JSON object. So the key will be SQL text and value will be query. Now next we are going to provide the binding. So key will be the binds and value will be one JSON array, and it is going to have our department number input variable. Yeah, that's it. Let me close this statement. Now we are going to get result set object. To get this object we'll use statement object, and we are going to execute a execute method. Once this method is executed we get a result set out of this query, and this result set will contain multiple records. So to extract the records we are going to iterate over it, so we can do it with the help of while loop. Let me create a while loop, and we are going to put a condition over here. Condition will be when we call the result set.next method will give us the true value, because record are present in our result set object. Once it gives the true value our iteration starts, and we are going to extract the value from result set object for the first record. Second time if record is present again it will run. When the record is not present then it will give false and we will come out of this loop. Now extract the value from result set object. So where we are going to place this value? So we are going to create one array. Let me create one array, and this is an empty array. We are going to push this result set object into our array. So we can do it with the help of push method of array. So let me place it, and in the end once all the record has been pushed into our array we can return this array using return keyword. That's it. So our stored procedure has been created. Let me compile it. So it has been compiled successfully. Let me call this. We can call stored procedure with the help of call command. Let's give the name. We can pass the department ID. Suppose I am passing department ID as 10. Let me run this. You can see we are getting one array. Let me copy it. You can see we are receiving two records inside this array, but we are supposed to get only employee name. So we can extract employee name out of this. So let me make a change in my query. Instead of giving star I need to give only ename. Let me recompile. Let me call my stored procedure. Let me copy the output. You can see we are getting the ename, but we are receiving several other columns as well in our record, and we don't need these columns. We will discuss about these columns in the later lectures. So we don't need these columns. So how can we remove these columns? Instead of putting whole result set inside the array, can call one function getColumnValue. And we want to receive only first column value, so we can place one over here. Let me recompile this. Let me execute my stored procedure. This time we are able to get enames. Let me check whether I'm getting the correct employee name or not. You can see for department number 10, we have King and Clark, and same we are getting in our stored procedures. So that's it, friend. This is the first stored procedure which we have created. We are going to create several other stored procedures in upcoming lectures. So thanks for watching this video. If you find this content helpful, subscribe to my channel, like my video, and share it with your friends. Thank you.